Good evening, everyone, and happy St Andrew's Day. My name is Elaine Smith, and as Deputy Presiding Officer, I'm delighted to welcome you to the Parliament and to the 9th annual St Andrew's Day debate. Today's debate and the wider competition that preceded it have been organised, as usual, in partnership with Education Scotland and the English Speaking Union. So I would like to start by thanking those involved from both those organisations for their hard work and their effort, which culminates in today's event. Thank you very much. Today, you're debating in a chamber that usually serves as the place where devolved legislation is enacted and policy matters are debated. And this chamber sees great diversity when it comes to debates. Sometimes the debates are very passionate, sometimes controversial, and then sometimes even consensus breaks out, with all sides agreeing that a piece of legislation or a motion for debate is too important for party political division. Of course, we don't expect consensus today, as the idea is to robustly put your case and to win. As I've chaired several of these St Andrew's Day debates, I'm always very impressed with the extremely high standard of debating. And who knows, maybe we've got some future MSPs and ministers among you today. I'm sure we have. As a parliamentarian and as the Deputy Presiding Officer, I'm also always very happy to lend my support to the competition, and I do have a bit of personal experience in debating. And so I know firsthand the skills and the knowledge that can be derived from debating a wide range of subjects, and that can be extremely rewarding and beneficial across many areas of life. And as a former teacher, it's also great for me to see so many schools participating and gaining debating skills at an early stage. I know all of our participants today and throughout the competition have been learning and improving their knowledge and skills, but perhaps more importantly, I hope that all the participants have also been having fun, and I hope that you continue to do that this afternoon. The unique style that this St Andrew's Day debate offers in its pairing of students from our schools and universities is clearly a successful formula as the contest goes from strength to strength. And the Scottish Parliament is always pleased to host this competition because it not only affords the opportunity for students and pupils to debate in this chamber, but it also provides us with an appropriate way of celebrating St Andrew's Day. As you will all know, St Andrew is Scotland's patron saint, a tradition which comes from the Orthodox and Christian churches. Saints often become the patron of places where they were born or had been active or where relics remain. St Andrew was crucified by the Romans on a diagonal cross, reported as taking place on the 30th November, and hence the choice of this day to mark his life. St Andrew's relics are at St Mary's Metropolitan Cathedral in Edinburgh, and this also provides Scots with a special link to Amalfi in Italy and Patras in Greece, where two cathedrals named after the saint also hold his relics. St Andrew's Day has been celebrated for generations by St Andrew's University students who traditionally get the day off. Scottish Parliament made St Andrew's Day an official holiday in Scotland in 2007, and the Parliament, constituency and government staff all get a holiday. And I was being heavily lobbied on Twitter by local school pupils at the weekend who also want a holiday for St Andrew's Day. So we need to put that case. St Andrew's influence is felt right across Scotland. And in my own area, we have a church, we have a high school, and we also have a hospice named after St Andrew. And further afield, there are many St Andrew's societies worldwide, and they were originally set up as self-help organisations for Scots who had fallen on hard times. They form a network of Scots who are all united under the saltire cross of St Andrew, and they include societies in places like Bermuda, Singapore and Washington DC. But bringing us back closer to home, more and more Scottish towns and cities are using St Andrew's Day as a platform to launch winter festivals and celebrations and to get us all through the dreich winter months. Today, as we look outside, we can see the cold dreich weather starting already. However, in here, it's a lot brighter because the chamber floor has been given over to some of Scotland's most talented young debaters. I wish our finalists all the best of luck and good luck to everyone else who is going to be taking part, I hope, in the open debate, which we're going to come to later. And basically all that's left for me to say is I hope you enjoy this afternoon's debate and the visit to your Scottish Parliament. Good luck, everyone, and thank you. So, Before I introduce the finalists today, I'm going to first of all introduce some really important people, the judges. Chairing the judging panel will be Alex Orr. Alex is the Managing Director of Orbit Communications, a public relations and a public affairs consultancy, and he is also Chairman of ESU Scotland. Thank you, Alex. Next on our judging panel, in the middle, we have Kezia Dugdale, MSP. Kezia is the leader of the Scottish Labour Party, and Kezia was first elected to the Scottish Parliament in 2011. And as well as leading the party, she also co-convenes the Parliament's cross-party group on drugs and alcohol and children and young people, two policy areas that she has a particular interest in. Nick Bibby, I knew I was going to say that, we have an MSP called Neil Bibby. Nick Bibby is the Communications Officer for the Centre on Constitutional Change based in Edinburgh. As a journalist, she's written for many of the well-known broadsheet newspapers and is an author and editor on the theory of debate. And Alex Dawn is a recent graduate in history from the University of St Andrews and is the current Speech and Debates Officer at ESU Scotland. He's the 2015 European Varsity Champion, Debating Champion, and the Cambridge InterVarsity Champion, and was a finalist at the 2014 St Andrews Day Debate. The St Andrews Day Debate also encourages pupils to join the judging panel for the debates held throughout this event, and so I'm delighted to welcome Michael Creehan of Holy Cross High School as the last member of our panel of judges. And as I said to Michael earlier, I'm particularly delighted since I at one time taught at Holy Cross in Hamilton. So I now want to congratulate and introduce the four teams that have made it to the final. The first team are Callum Fairbairn from Falkirk High School and Abigail Van Schalkwyk from the University of Edinburgh, and they will be known as Falkirk Van Schalkwyk. Next, we have Hannah McLaughlin from St Columba's High School and Katie McLean from the University of Edinburgh, and they will be known as Columba McLean. We also have Luca Del Pippo from Perth High School and Elliot Porter from the University of Glasgow, and that team will be known as Perth Porter. And finally, we have Jenny Purdy from Mar College and Chris Edgar from the University of Glasgow, and that team will be known as Mar Edgar. So, just before we begin, I would like to outline the format of the debate. I will call on the first proposition speaker to speak, and they have 5 minutes. I will then call on the first opposition speaker to speak, and they also have 5 minutes. This will be repeated for each speaker. During the 8 speeches, I will verbally announce when your first minute is up. I think I forgot last year on one occasion. I'll try and do it right this year. And this will indicate that points of information are now permitted. I will also verbally indicate when you have entered your last minute, during which no more points of information will be allowed. When your 5 minutes are up, I will ask you to wind up, and if you continue further, I will ask again for you to wind up after 30 seconds. Now, as you may know, in my role as Deputy Presiding Officer, I'm tasked with keeping the members of the Scottish Parliament to time when speaking in the chamber, as Kezia will no doubt attest, and I trust that this debate will follow in a similar fashion. Please use the clocks around the chamber for reference, because these will be timing you. And after the final speech for the opposition, I will then ask our judges to retire to make their very difficult, no doubt, decision. At this point, I will then open the debate to the floor of the chamber for around 30 minutes. And I hope that everyone as much as possible will participate in the floor debate, because there will be an award for the best contribution from the floor as well. The motion for today's final is: this House believes that governments should prioritise economic equality at the expense of the nation's overall prosperity. Which now takes us on to getting the final started, and best of luck to you all. So, I would like to call the first speaker from Falkirk Van Schalkwyk to open the debate as the first proposition speaker. 5 minutes, please. Sorry if people just remain at desk. if perhaps should have explained that as well, so I apologise. The red light should come on in the microphone in front of you. Please feel free to stand up as members of Parliament do. So we'll start the 5 minutes. Thank you.
Good afternoon. We will be proposing the motion that this House would prioritise economic equality at the expense of overall prosperity. And to define this motion, we believe a basic income should be provided to all citizens at a level which ensures basic dignity and quality of life. And of course, funding is essential in this debate, so we would ensure this was properly funded by increasing tax rates on large businesses and high net worth individuals. This would be alongside other policies to promote social mobility and the development of the working classes and projects to expand people's horizons. I'll be covering several main points today about why the current system is not fit for purpose in the modern age and leads to significant inequalities, about how the government has a basic duty to ensure a basic standard of living for everyone in society, and about how prioritising economic equality would lead to this being delivered.
First minute.
So, first of all, I look at how the current system is not fit for purpose. Currently, we have record levels of inequality across Scotland and the UK. Food bank use is up. People are out of work, and there's a widening gap between the richest and the poorest in society. At the same time as people are being forced to use food banks for their basic needs, there are record sales of things such as private jets and boats. This is all because the current capitalist economic system, supported by the current government, prioritises individualism over collectivism and concern for fellow citizens. This leads to entrenched inequality and a wealth gap in society, as I alluded to. The current government, as many previous, have implemented many policies that are supposed to improve equality in society, but the figures show that these simply have not worked. And the another fact is that the main effect of inequality in society is on the poorest, the women and ethnic minorities, who often cannot fulfil a full role in the economy. Maybe they cannot work due to caring for children or other family members. And we believe that if we had a basic income for all citizens, these people, and along with everyone in society, would be able to fulfil their basic and full potential. Secondly, we believe one of the basic and most fundamental rights of all governments worldwide, including in Scotland and the UK, is to provide a basic quality of life for all citizens. This means a life free from shame, of humiliation, of begging. Currently, this is not the case for many people across the country. And we believe this is out of touch with the modern liberal image that Britain, yes.
Does giving people who are already at the bottom of society a little bit more money actually make them any more equal or just a little bit more well off?
Of course, the policy we are proposing would not, you know, it wouldn't ensure total equality, but what it would do is ensure that the poorest people in society have a basic standard of living, and we believe that is essential for everyone. So we believe that the current levels of inequality and the rampant inequality, of course, figures have recently shown that it is only rising across the country. We believe that it's out of touch with the modern liberal Britain that the country is supposed to be and should be. We believe that current policies implemented by recent governments, such as the decision to cut the 50p top rate of tax, have only added to this inequality. We believe our policy of giving people a basic income would allow people a basic dignity. It would make sure they have a roof over their head, they can provide basic food for their family, and it would ensure they're free from stresses and anxieties caused by inequality. My third point.
Final minute.
Prioritising economic equality would fulfil this duty. It would ensure that everyone in society, no matter what their wealth or age or background, feels part of the society and feels that their efforts are valued. It would ensure that wealth and success are shared equally across society rather than amongst the richest few, as is currently the case. And this would, far from damaging the economy, this would in fact improve the economy overall, as everyone could reach their full potential, free of the traps of poverty. So to conclude, we believe the current capitalist economic system in the UK places a burden on the poorest people in society, and in fact favours the richest people in society. We believe the government has a duty to provide a basic level of living where people can live in accommodation and with adequate food. We believe that prioritising economic equality would fulfil this duty to all in society and ensure that everyone, no matter what their age, background, income or where they live, could live with a basic standard of living, and that should be a given in this country in the year 2015. Thank you.
Thank you, Callum. I would now like to call the first speaker from Columba McLean to open as the first opposition speaker, please. 5 minutes. Woo!
Ladies, gentlemen, Madam Chair, economic equality doesn't come from when we just tax businesses a little bit more money each year. We're going to prove to you why economic equality only comes when a country is financially stable in the long run and why a country is financially stable as a society and not just on an individual level. I'm going to be proving this to you on two ways. Firstly, looking at why economic prosperity equals stability, and then secondly, why on the reverse, this motion causes instability and the impacts that it negatively has on all the workers and people who the proposition are trying to protect and trying to help and make their lives a lot more worse in the long run. But firstly, I'm going to start with a tiny bit of rebuttal. So what we're trying to do is like basically show that they have this argument about people being out of work and how this is going to like protect these people and get it better. As Katie's going to come on telling her case, at which the country, the government actually has less money as it is much harder for any other businesses to have the incentive to come into a country that is financially unstable due to the fact the government is giving out more money to its citizens and not retaining that money as a comfort blanket and security net, as I'm going on to explain. This is why we think that's just wrong. And secondly, this idea of the universal income. We don't think universal income does anything to help these people in the long run, because all it does is give them a little bit more money than they already had in the first place. You never give them equality. It doesn't spread equality. You give them a little bit more, but it's not going to ever make them equal to anyone else in society. That doesn't work. Okay, so let's look at my case. Firstly, looking at why economic prosperity equals stability. Because why does having a surplus amount of money as a government actually make you a more stable and effective government in the long run? Because it's a little bit of money, when in times of recession or crisis, you have a security. You have the knowledge that, in fact, you're not going to have no money to bail out your banks, to bail out your businesses when you have a recession. You have that security of knowing that you're a stable country that has that money. We point to the example of Germany, when in the recession was able to have less redundancies and actually maintain a more stable economy due to the fact they had extra money in their government to allow them to not have to cut as many people's jobs, not have to tackle their economy more, but keep them in relatively the same place as they were before. On the comparative, Greece, a country that didn't have any of that money, didn't have any security nets because all they did is like borrow money and they had no money in their government, ended up in a situation where none of the people were stable at all. They had no businesses wanting to invest. Everyone was moving out. The country went into a crippling nation that never has not been able to get back out of that recession. We think that is the sort of situation that occurs. Therefore, what happens when a recession comes? Because we think this proves that countries with more money effectively have the ability to maintain stability in the long run, because they have the security of knowing they are a stable country and not feeling as if they don't have the money to back up their jobs. But why does this matter? Because firstly, we think when an economy fails, I'll take you a second, it's really bad. Yes.
When a country like Germany raises lots of capital to stabilise their budget, this actively harms prosperity because companies do not want to invest because their profits will be taxed away. How does your policy actually gel with creating prosperity?
Okay, what we think it does is Germany, even if it is taxing businesses more, we think it has that extra money anyway. At the point at which in Britain you don't have that stability because you're giving all your money away to more individuals, you're never going to be able to tax these businesses because you don't have a credibility. But let's look why it matters when economies fail and when recessions hit. Because we don't think it is the CEOs of companies that get fired when a recession hits. We think it's the ground roots workers who work 9 to 5 days and whose jobs don't really matter in the long run of that company, who don't really have that much of a say in how that company is run and only get like minimum income. At this point, you are actively harming and detrimenting the lives of these people that proposition is trying to tell you they are defending, because you are stopping them from having a job that is ever going to allow them to be financially stable or prosperous, because they don't have the opportunity to do so. The point of this is that you have to hinge your own prosperity on the fact that your economy is able to support you and give you a job, because we think you don't get that job when companies are less incentivised to come into your country. But we think And that is why this cripples the nation. Because on an individual level, you allow jobs to the breadwinners of families to completely stop having a job and not be able to support their family. But you stop that economy on a national level being able to function and make any money in the long run. Now let's look quickly at why companies, when companies fail, is extremely bad as well. Because even in times of like, when there's a good nature in the economy, it is worse when a company, we think happens likely, often fails or often like comes into liquidation. At this point, when a government is putting all its money into more individuals and not having that safety net, it is much harder for them to help actual individuals who don't have any money because they've lost their job, who don't have any support to get that, because it's a lot harder for a government to find money that they possibly don't have. At this point, not only do you harm the lives of those individuals, you harm the lives of the rest of their families and all these vulnerable individuals who are never going to be financially prosperous under this motion, but only become more and more in poverty and not being able to get out of it at the point at which you lose your job. Ladies and gentlemen, because this motion actively harms the lives of all the citizens who proposition want to help, and means you never get stability in the long run, and that stability only comes when you are financially prosperous as a society and a nation, I've never been prouder to oppose. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Hannah. Can I now call the second proposition speaker from Falkirk Van Schalkwyk to give us their views, please. Abigail, 5 minutes.
Today I'm going to be speaking about, firstly, how this is necessarily going to maximise the ability of individuals to self-actualise and contribute to society, and secondly, how this better actually helps traditionally disadvantaged groups. Before I go on to both of these things, I'd like to do some rebuttal, right? Firstly, right, first opposition stands up and they say to you, well, firstly, giving them a little bit of money isn't necessarily going to help. At the point where the money allows them not to queue up at a food bank, to put a roof over their head and feed their children, we don't think that is like insignificant in terms of this debate, right? We think it is largely beneficial to large society in which we don't have large amounts of people depending on food banks, right? Secondly, this idea of, you know, you have instability if you're spending money without a surplus, we just think it's untrue insofar as like most major economies do rely on a deficit. We just don't think it's necessarily true that you need a surplus necessarily to run a really good economy. Thirdly, right, we think this thing that they say, right, that companies are like won't be incentivized to come to the UK insofar as we're giving more people money. So, firstly, we think companies are still going to be incentivized to come to the UK insofar as it is still a massive market for them to break into. We think there are other economic advantages that mean the companies are still going to come in and still operate in Britain insofar as there are these advantages and it is a massive market, right? No, thank you, right? Fourthly, right, they say that they don't think it's necessarily going to give them equality. We think on both sides of the house, equality for these people is like poorly done, right? We think at least on our side, we give them a basic lifeline on which to exist and a basic standard like ability to live and actually like maximize their potential, which is what I'm going to get onto now, right? Firstly, right, we think that the duty of the government is to help individuals like maximize their full potential, right? We think at the point we can give them a basic standard which to live fully with human dignity, right, and allow them to actually live their lives in a way that isn't constrained by poverty, isn't constrained by the ability to be able to feed their children, we think that is an inherent good, right? Like, secondly, right, no thank you, like people's ability to self-actualize is often dependent on their financial, like, status and, like, what they're able to do, right? Government should ensure that everyone is given, like, some form of economic equality by giving the poor more so that they're better able to self-actualize, right? We think that's an incredibly good benefit that happens on our side of the house, right? We think this is more important than any of the like small harms that may arrive on your side of the house, right? So like, secondly, right, what happens, right, is like, we think that what happens under the status quo, this is not just true for the absolute poorest in society, we think it is also true for large groups of people, right? We think financial straits like prevent them disproportionately from doing what they actually want to, right? We think often we probably have more businesses and more people actually innovating insofar as they're not too scared to take the risk to be able to do things at the point where they're given a basic lifeline, right? We think people who are poorer off are less able to take risks, be innovators, and create businesses insofar as if they lose their job for doing that or spend less time doing their job, they're probably going to starve to death, right? We also think, like, often, like, some of these jobs are incredibly, like, some of these things, people who are on the lower end of the pay spectrum do, like, provide proper services and great services, there are nurses, teachers, things like that, at the ability where they're more able to perform those roles without worrying about being poorly paid or completely on the lower end of the income. We probably have more good jobs that happen. Even the jobs that aren't necessarily important to the status quo, we still think it's incredibly important, right? We think at the point where we can allow people by giving them a basic income and the ability to be equal no matter what their jobs are, we think they're more able to like pursue passions that they have. They're more able to go into things like art, more able to go into certain artistic adventures, right? which otherwise they wouldn't be able to insofar as they are the poorest people in society and often aren't able to because of the financial constraints that exist, right? Yes.
How likely am I to be an innovator and want to create a new business when my economy is unstable and won't support that business in the long run?
We just don't buy that giving more people money is going to make an economy unstable, right? Look at all the states that actually exist in somewhat socialist schemes, right? They're completely stable countries, right? We think Scandinavian models work perfectly fine, right? We think that it's completely untrue for them to mischaracterise this debate, right? Secondly, how's this going to better help socially disadvantaged groups, right? So firstly, right, when nations' overall prosperity exists, it only benefits a small group of people, right? We think it benefits people generally at the top, right? The people that are disproportionately affected are often women and people of lower socioeconomic differences. Firstly, women, right? We think women, because of social structures, gender norms, and family commitments, they're often in the lower paid part-time positions. They are more effectively disproportionately affected by, economic inequality, right? We think at the point we prioritize economic equality and do actual schemes that actually benefit them more, we think we are more likely to be able to actually help people who are, an entire generation that is more, affected by this kind of thing, right? We think also, poorer people generally will be able to actually be more supported under this motion, right? We think at the point where they're given a lifeline and more money and able to have actual equality, right? We think that what happens is they're basically able to self-actualize and actually be able to feel like they are part of society and contribute to society, right? We basically think, right, there is a fairer way of living in today's society. We think the government's role is to ensure that the basic standard of living exists and that people are as able to maximize their potential as possible. We think this motion is the best way in which to do this. And if we can prove that it's true, we think no matter what harms they bring and the minimized harms they bring, far outweighed by that. For all of these reasons, we beg you to propose.
Thank you, Abigail. Can I now ask the second opposition speaker from Columba MacLean to speak? And that will be Katie. 5 minutes, please.
Okay, so ladies and gentlemen, we think to an extent proposition has misunderstood or purposely tried to avoid their main burden in this debate today. It isn't to prove that they can stop one family from going to one food bank because they've given them a bit more of the government's money. It is ultimately prioritising those individuals' lives to cause them some equality by therefore stopping their government and state from being as prosperous. We think if they were to engage with the reality of what they have to prove on their side of the debate today, they would lose. And we've started to prove to you already on opposition why that is true. We don't think they can just tell us they can help one family by their model. They have to prove that there is a certain equality that is reached under their side of the house, and if they don't do it, we win. So I'm going to be looking furthermore at what Hannah's told you in my case. So Hannah's already explained to you what happens when, in terms of jobs and things, when you leave vulnerable people open to losing them when an economy fails and also when a company fails, as we've looked at when a relatively weak economy, which this will be when they are spending most of their money as they are prioritising it on giving it into living wages instead of otherwise. I'm going to explain why we think it's unlikely you're going to have those jobs there in the first place anyway, and we're going to engage more fully with their idea of universal income. But before that, we're going to start with some rebuttal. So Closing Up stands up on a point of information to Hannah and tells you we've misunderstood why Germany was still rich, they taxed lots of businesses really heavily. So you think, first of all, no, that's not the only reason why Germany managed to stay rich. They did things like spend less money, so they had more left over to look after themselves. But second of all, if they want to argue that taxation and having all that money meant that Germany was heavily taxing people and that resulted in businesses wanting to not stay in those countries and that sort of thing so much. We say that's exactly what they're doing under their side of the house, some preemptive rebuttal to whatever they're going to say in theirs. Then second of all, right, we think it wasn't okay for them just to poo-poo Hannah's analysis when she tells you all of this stuff about how it is exactly the people they want to help under their model, when she talks about the vulnerable people who work in companies that fall when at the point at which an economy is has less money to support them in an emergency situation, which they will have less money, no thanks, if they spent it all on providing universal income, right? And we think it is those people that we help. Then she tells you about people being able to pursue risky or entrepreneurial things in a situation where they don't have enough money to do so in the first place. First of all, we think that's not the only reason why people feel like it. It's because they think that that company might not succeed, for example, which we reckon is even more likely in a society in which your economy, as Hannah has proved, and they barely analysed as to why it was untrue, was stable. And finally, she gives you this idea idea about minorities, and we say the best way to get people into, like, in general, like, into work and have a good time is to have, like, a good job, like, building atmosphere. We don't get that under their side of the house, we get it on ours. So let's look at mine. No, thank you. So first of all, we think that in terms of, like, what happens when people, why we don't think people will set up, we think there's a couple of reasons companies will be disincentivized to set up in our nations under in their world, right? Why is that? Firstly, we think that it is quite risky to put yourself into a country where, like, most of their money is being spent on, like, social welfare instead of, like, a safety net in a situation. Let's look at examples of where that is true. So we say that, like, one of the big arguments for staying in the European Union, for example, is that it works as an excellent safety net if you were to get into trouble, is that other economies can rush in and save you, because having that extra money kicking about is always viewed as a good thing in investors' eyes when they think it's going to be safe. But secondly, we just think it's true that when you have things like minimum wage or living wage, which is significantly more expensive, it is a disincentive for people to invest in those countries because they have to spend more money as a result of that. For those reasons, we think those jobs don't exist. I'll take opening.
The UK economy is completely different to the economies in Europe that are currently struggling, like Greece, and you have more people able to spend money in the economy by having more. Surely that's good for the economy.
Okay, so we just don't think it's true that, like, we think basically you can only spend as much as your economy is, like, giving you the ability to. We think when there are less jobs, like, for example, we just think that although living wage is, like, fine, okay, like, it's good that people have a bit of money, whatever, we think, one, that has harms, but two, that's not as much as you would earn if you were in a job, right? Here's why all of these things, all the things they tell you, right? So the biggest issues facing people in terms of, like, why we have economic inequality is things like unemployment. It's things like youth unemployment, for example. And we think when there's less companies and businesses willing to invest in, like, the youth and that sort of thing in a company, it's less likely to happen. But second of all, right, we think it's we also think you're more likely to, like, give better opportunities and better job opportunities to people who think they can rise to the top in a business. We think the problem is when your business is cut off at the top because the country in which it operates is not one of, like, high fiscal worth, it's very disincentive. But finally, and this is the most important part, right, is that we think that basically if you are told that the country in which you are investing will only ever be able to reach this, like, certain standard and certain height in terms of the money it makes, we think that means you're more likely to set up elsewhere and it doesn't benefit the people they tell you about, because you don't get any of the benefits under their side of the house and you harm the most vulnerable. You should oppose this motion.
Thank you, Katie, and thank you to both teams. Can I now ask the first speaker from Perth Porter to open the case for the closing proposition team, please? 5 minutes.
The push for prosperity in any policy is the most destructive economic pursuit a government can pursue. We say our mechanisms are particularly biased in favour of risky behaviour, they're destructive to the economy, and we see it as critical that we about-face and change our policy drastically. We accept there will be slower growth on our side, we accept significant drops to the consumer's utility garnered. We're happy to say this is better overall for our citizens. 3 points. Firstly, one very quick point of characterisation. We think it's going to be a social democracy, what it looks like, what sort of economy we'll have. Next, onto the purpose of wealth creation in our economy, why we think that's crucial. And lastly, on the intrinsic instability and destructive pursuits of prosperity-oriented capitalism. What we say first in rebuttal. The claim firstly, the claim we get from opening is that prosperity exists when a government has a significant amount of capital in reserve. We say this is fundamentally not true. For exactly the reasons that the second speaker just conceded, when you tax a lot of people's companies, they're less likely to set up, they're less likely to trade in your company, that's less likely to drive growth. We are eating that harm. We are happy to accept that because we believe we get certain benefits out of it. But the entire opposition case we got is predicated on the assumption that you will have lots and lots of excess capital in your economy if you're prosperous. We don't think that's true. On to the substantive material. What alternative do we think we're going to get? Firstly, we think it's going to look like a social democracy. This will be like Sweden, this will be like Denmark, perhaps like Norway, but we accept they have a certain benefit of a sovereign wealth fund. We think we're going to have high wages, we think we're going to have niche industries, we think we're going to have slow growth. That's okay. What do we think the purpose of wealth creation is? It is to bring benefits to the lives of your citizenry. We measure this largely by GNI per capita, GDP per capita, to some extent by current currency. The problem is this creates an illusion. We do not distribute this wealth per capita. It is tied up in land, it is tied up in valuable goods, it is tied up in dividends paid to shareholders. Do you think this is fundamentally harmful? Firstly, because it creates the perception that our country is significantly more wealthy than it is. We think this is harmful because it changes how government behaves and it leads to the erasure of the poorest people in society. We think it's important. Secondly, we think there is no significant multiplier of this capital. It is not useful to have capital in banks. It is not useful to our economy that capital is spent shoring up the share price of a company by paying higher dividends. We think fundamentally this is harmful. No, thank you. What we'd rather see? This money being significantly shifted towards the poorest because they are more likely to consume it and they're more likely to consume it locally. They do not save as much money because they need to spend in order to maintain a standard of living. They're more likely to spend it locally, providing jobs to people in their local economy. They're most likely to build by cheap consumer goods, a cheap car built in your country rather than German or Japanese cars. We think this is useful for creation of jobs in your economy. This is the only way you get significant economic development. We think it's slower, we think it is intrinsically valuable. What do we think you get when you have a particularly equality-oriented economy? We think the state is likely to pursue longitudinal economic policies. Why? Because when equality is your primary concern, you do not engage in high-risk behaviour. High-risk behaviour leads to inequality. This means your only thing you can use to pursue to provide growth is infrastructural projects, is long-term projects. We think these are particularly useful. What do we think, and this is crucial, what do we think is intrinsic to any government policy that pursues prosperity? Look particularly at the UK. We are largely reliant on our financial sector. Financial tools are the only thing the UK make that anyone wants to buy. I'll take you a moment.
When does the problem look like it's been solved? When you've given these people a universal basic income and gone, OK, that's you now? Or when you can see people are still struggling and you can help those specific individuals rather than just giving an equal amount of money to everyone?
It is fairly apparent when someone is still struggling. We're happy to have extensive policies, as opening said. We're happy to model our economy largely like Sweden. Our objective is to have very low inequality. Particular government actions can be extensive. We really don't care the particular mechanisms. The debate is about whether we value growth in our economy overall, whether we value being an economic superpower, or we value a decent life to all of our citizenry. We think it was particularly important. These financial tools that are built in the UK are not based on any actual change in the world. The increased value, because I can sell you a financial tool, does not make the material world change. Therefore, you're more likely to have an economic market crash. You're susceptible to these crashes because the value is not pegged to anything. This is crucial. Why do you think crashes are integral to these sorts of policies? It is because you only get high returns when you engage in high-risk behaviour. Safe bets are always on low return. We think it's in their side, the state is explicitly supporting high-risk behaviour. What does this look like? Probably tax cuts to large companies so that they can absorb losses. We will be the lender of last resort. We think we're also going to deregulate banks under their side. I think this is probably significantly dangerous at the point at which you say, we want to get rich fast, engage in as much risky behaviour as you like, we'll cover you. Why is this harmful? Well, firstly, when you do have a loss of confidence in your currency, for instance, you're less likely to be able to deploy capital to build infrastructural projects. Recognise also there's an opportunity cost. Every single time the state says, I will pay for your losses. That is nurses that cannot be employed. That is railways that cannot be repaired. This is electricity grids that cannot be updated, meaning that people in your country are significantly poorer. You cannot push wealth in a slow and sustainable way when you're reliant on high-risk, high-return capitalism. We see this is why countries like the UK are devastated by economic crashes, where countries like Sweden and Norway and Denmark weather them reasonably well. They do not rely on high-risk behaviour. They do not pursue prosperity at any great rate. And we think for very, very clear reasons, this economic policy is the only one that significantly benefits your citizens. It's the only one that can be sustainable. It's the only one that provides the sorts of goods we require. Madam Presiding Officer, I'm very happy to return after many, many years to this illustrious chamber. It has been good fun. I've spent a lot of time training in the Glasgow University Chamber on these grounds. I think I'm almost at time now. I thank you all for your time.
You're out of time. Thank you. Thank you, Elliot. I would now like to call the first speaker from Mark Edgar to open the case for the closing opposition team, please.
The opening government case is irrelevant to equality, therefore irrelevant to this debate. It is simply a case for welfare, i.e. give £200,000 to all, or £20,000 to all poor people so that they don't have to go to food banks. Recognise all of their benefits still accrue if simultaneously you're also given double that amount of money to all rich people, thereby increasing the economic inequality. It still solves their case. So they only care about absolute poverty, not relative poverty. That being true, they should join opposition on this side of the debate. The case that we're going to bring you from closing opposition is why the absolute quality of your life is far more important than the quality of your life relative to other people. That is why prosperity should be prioritised over equality. From closing government, we hear that wealth creation must benefit the citizenry, which is exactly what we're going to attempt to prove as the case on our side. The rest of the closing government case is essentially trying to cheat the debate by arguing that their side, despite sacrificing the economy, is better for the economy in some weird way. This is failing to live up to meeting his own clash which he set up, which was trading off the economy against equality. He then tried to tell you that money in banks isn't useful, despite the fact that that is what facilitates mortgages and business startup loans. We think it probably is good for the economy. Let's look at why we win this debate from closing opposition. First of all, we'll demonstrate why prosperity improves your quality of life as an individual. First of all, on healthcare, this requires a government to be able to spend lots of money on its NHS. If you suffer economically, you can spend less money on this. You care about the length of your life and the absence of pain in absolute terms, not relative to how much pain and how long other people are living, right? Your life is the most important thing to you because it's the means by which you experience all of the happiness and all of the pleasure in your life. Without your life, there can be no value and there can be nothing which you can call good. This needs to, therefore, matter in absolute terms. So it doesn't matter if someone else's life, if someone else's life is extended in an extra 3 years, if your life is extended an extra 2 years, that is still a massive benefit from you. But this costs money, and this is money that proposition no longer have because they've sacrificed prosperity. Second, defence of the realm. When a state is poorer in absolute terms, it can't afford the same defence budget. 2% of your GDP just isn't worth as much money in real terms. No, thank you. This means fewer troops or military hardware, so it's harder to secure your foreign policy interest abroad. This means weaker security services, so you're more susceptible to attack. The risk of terrorism increases. This is a direct, real harm to everybody in your state. Thirdly, infrastructure projects are harder to finance. Again, this requires raw capital from your government, and it's unconnected to how equal citizens are compared to each other. Motorways, public transport expansions all require money. On their side of the house, these fall gradually further and further behind the times, because this is something that evolves over time. Obviously, if they enact this policy now, it makes a slight difference every year, which compounds and compounds. So in 100 years' time, our railways are completely dilapidated. The same applies to a number of public funding things. Education also suffers as a result. I'll take a PY now if you want before I move on. No? Okay, I'll move on. We also, second point, we also care about equality beyond borders. We're not sure why my economic advantage over someone in Glasgow or someone in Plymouth is more harmful than my economic advantage over someone in Central Africa. From opposition, we stand for a world which is best capable to redress the inequalities between states. When we're richer, we're better able to do that. Why? First of all, we can spend more on foreign aid. Again, on our side of the house, 0.7% of your GDP is just a bigger sum of money. This means when it is a smaller sum of money on their side of the house, that means they can afford fewer vaccinations, they can build fewer schools, they have fewer wells for clean drinking water for people, they have less crisis relief for when natural disasters occur. This means direct, significant harm to people who, under their metrics, should be the most vulnerable, who are at least equal to the extent that that is a useful phrase. Elliot.
I gave you analysis as to why pursuing prosperity is particularly unstable and most likely to harm the poorest, making them less wealthy than the mean. What was your response to the particular...
Our side is prioritising prosperity, i.e. growth. You are arguing that by prioritising growth, you get less growth. That clearly doesn't make sense and clearly isn't what the comparison in this debate is supposed to be about. Second of all, on this point, you're less able to invest in green energy. We think the places most at risk of climate change are developing world economies. There are big inequalities between us and them. Why do side proposition not care about those inequalities? We think a prosperous state is better placed to take the economic hit of investing in slightly less efficient green technology. Thirdly and finally, returning to the defensive point you talked about earlier, it is harder to perform humanitarian interventions when you have a weaker army on your side of the house, harder to help the most vulnerable people in the world. What have we brought you from this debate? This is a comparison between inequalities and prosperity. When you have prosperity, in absolute terms, you're better off. I've demonstrated why being absolutely better off is far more important to you than being slightly better off in relation to other people. Oppose the motion.
Thank you, Chris. And I now call on the second speaker from Perth Porter to conclude the case for the proposition. I think that would be Luca.
Okay, hi. Today I'm going to explain why the proposition has won the debate, put forth points for economic stability, and overall made valid contributions to the debate. The purpose of economic growth, I don't think anyone can disagree with, is to solely benefit the people of the nation it's serving. No one can disagree with that. But the fact is, our current economic system doesn't benefit the people. It benefits a very few number of people at the top, no one at the bottom. The very people who work, for these companies get a staggering little amount of percentage of the income the general company makes. Large companies, our economy is based on the financial sector primarily, as looking at Britain. These companies don't even invest in production anymore, like the traditional capitalist system would. They invest in hedge funds, which essentially produce money out of money, which is just, it's ridiculous. It's not providing jobs, the very things that they seek out that they claim, and then when they do get in trouble from bad investments that they've made in said hedge funds, they ask for taxpayers' money to bail them out. This is ridiculous. This has to stop. It's extremely unsustainable, the current system. It's extremely unsustainable and is proven time and time again. When there's another economic collapse, we absorb that shock, the working people. They don't. The people have trillions. We do, taxpayer money, and we bail them out. I think... accepted.
What happens to the people who are now only surviving on the living wage that you give them under their side of the house when the recession hits and you have no money to help anybody who's, right, like, lost their job?
It's specifically because you use the word when the recession hits that points out the ills of capitalism. Because when we actually have a reform, there shouldn't be any recession because everything is proportionate into how much a person works. It's that's more in the mechanism of it, but as we've said, we don't have enough time to go over that in depth. I feel that we should look towards countries like Denmark and Sweden, who have proven to us that social democracy works and works very well. They are much more technologically advanced than us, they are much more ecologically advanced than us, and they have a better education system and a world-class health system. These are all things that come of social democracy. Equality is actually positive for an economy, contrary to your beliefs. It's positive because the state can look at longer-term economic plans like infrastructure in general, such as railways, roads, trams, as we have in Edinburgh. These things actually contribute to the economy slowly over time, but they are safe bets. They are safe bets. They always contribute to the economy and make a positive impact, but on a slower scale. So, when there are collapses caused by the current economic system, people lose their jobs or get paid less. Now, you may say, well, this encourages productivity. This will drag the economy back over. That's just morally and ethically wrong, being told to work harder for less because the economy has failed you. This needs to change also. People are forced to go to food banks or sleep in the streets when they lose their jobs or get paid less. Is this what economic prosperity means to you as a 21st century Western power? Food banks, people going to food banks, people going homeless. This isn't right and it needs reform. I have some rebuttals. Firstly, we gave you the analysis on why the trickle-down effect doesn't actually work and you haven't supplied evidence that it does work at all. In fact, you've actually supplied us evidence of poverty and inequalities. You made this absurd claim that life while defending the necessity of poverty in a social order. This is just totally absurd that you can even begin to defend the quality of life while promoting poverty. Again, contrary to your belief that for some reason international aid is slowed down because of economic reform, we actually could potentially spend more on international aids and all these other things that I mentioned in the current social democracies if we stop spending so much on bailing banks out and bailing big companies out. You get growth in a society. It's just... Sorry, you get growth... Yes, you get growth in this society, in this economic form, but it's not spread out evenly. You hear on the news, like, oh, the economy's down, the economy's up. You think that's a good thing, but it really only benefits the top 1%. It doesn't benefit any of us because we are a fixed wage. Yeah. Workers, you also said that workers can have the aspiration to go to a CEO of the company and become, you know, rise to that rank. But that's just not true, and I think you you know that it's not true, and that rarely, rarely happens in that case, that it's actually elected by the shareholders who say, well, this guy can make more profit because he comes from a privileged background and he knows the business and he knows this guy who's also part of that company. It's almost an aristocracy. It's not a form of working in meritocracy.
You must conclude.
Cooperatives under which the new... Cooperatives under the new economic reform do not require greater ownership, therefore have more stability, and the workers who run it have a say in how it's run. I thank you for listening to us, and I beg you to make this to vote for the proposition in this historic reform. Thank you.
Thank you, Luca. Can I now call the final speaker, please, from Mar Edgar to conclude the case for the opposition. Our fourth opposition speaker, 5 minutes, please, Jenny.
So my role in concluding this debate will be threefold. I would first like to take this opportunity to respond to the opening proposition, then I will go on to respond to the closing proposition, and then I will sum up why the closing opposition should win this case. The opening government are providing welfare. This is what they've suggested. They want to provide welfare to their people. So in absolute terms, which my partner has already discussed with you, this would mean that their minimum wage would continue to get smaller and smaller and smaller, because the people, the gap between the rich and the poor is continually shifting downwards and downwards and downwards. And then, so in response to the closing proposition, any step towards equality will not give us prosperity. Having to rely on a food bank is bad in absolute terms. It doesn't matter how many other people are relying on a food bank. You would still be relying on a food bank. We still think that would be bad, because just because everyone is equal and they're all relying on food banks, that doesn't mean that that's a good thing. You shouldn't have to rely on a food bank to get your food. And in the equality sense, everyone would be relying on a food bank. Now, I would like to take this position to sum up the closing opposition. So we believe that equality is unattainable. The poor would still be poor, whether or not everyone is equal, because the margin is continually shifting downwards. The rich are getting poorer, and the poor are also getting poorer. In the case of morality, we should also look not just to equality within our own states, but to equality between different states. If you care about being richer or poorer than someone in your own country, then why should you not care that the people in Africa are going to be poorer than you, or perhaps the people in France would be richer than you? Does that matter? Because in absolute terms, you're saying that in relative terms, you're saying that everyone should be equal, and that we, even as a country, we should be equal, but we should also be... I'll take this second.
Saying that everyone should have equal pay, we're saying that everyone should have, that we should put economic equality before prosperity. That's not to say everyone earns the same thing. That's to say that people earn more fair according to how much they work.
But in order to do this, this is going to cost the government more money. And where are we going to get this money from? Anyway, to continue on with my point, the closing opposition would like to conclude that absolute quality of life is more important than the relative quality of life. As my partner has already told you, if you were expected to exceed your life expectancy by 2 years, why should it matter that somebody else is going to... Sorry, take it in a minute. Why should it matter that somebody else is going to exceed their life expectancy by 3 years? Because your quality of life is still going to be better during those 2 years, and it should not matter if you are going to live... If your neighbour was going to live for 3 years and you were going to live for two, because you would still have 2 years of extra life. It should not matter whether what other people have. Why should we care what everyone else is like? Because it's your life, and your 2 years will matter more to you than the other person's 3 years will matter to you. Prosperity does not equal equality. Spending more on foreign aid, since we have more money on our side because we have not been giving it just away to people. We're not taking all the money and spreading it equally between everyone. We are taking the money and giving people what they deserve based on the job that they do. Then we are going to have more money. We are going to have more money to spend on looking after foreign aid in different countries, which is our responsibility as a country to look after people in other countries. And we would not be able to fulfil this to as great a We would not be able to fulfil this to as great extent on your side as we would on our side. But I would just like to conclude my argument with this. Our side believes that equality in the absolute sense is the most important. What I want you to take from this is that it does not matter what other people have. It does not matter whether your neighbour makes £30,000, whether your neighbour is going to live 3 years longer than you. It doesn't matter because you earn what you need and you are going to live the life that you lead. And this is why I, on behalf of the opposition, would urge you to oppose this motion.
Thank you, Jenny. Can I thank all 8 speakers for their contributions to the debate? That concludes the debate, this part of it, and I would now like to ask the judges if they could leave us to deliberate on what I'm sure is going to be a very difficult decision. And can I ask you to please return in about 20 minutes or so? Thank you. Okay, so we are now going to move to the floor debate, and this will last for about 30 minutes. That gives the judges time to make the deliberations and get the results back up to me. I'm going to invite speakers from the floor to raise points in relation to the debate and the points that you've just heard. If you want to speak, then if you could please raise your hand. If selected, you wait for the red light to come on your microphone and stand up if you can. If not, then remain seated, that's fine. Tell the chamber your name and the name of your school or university before you raise your point, please. And that's extremely important because I have got to identify a winner. And I would also be grateful if you could limit your contribution to 1 minute. Please remember, there's a prize for the best floor speech of the evening. So if you don't say who you are, then your brilliant contribution is not going to be counted towards the prize. So if we could start, if I could see a show of hands, and I will try to get as many in as I possibly can in the time allocated. Okay, so young woman here, yep, please. We have the microphone, thank you.
This is, I'm Emma Dunn from Calderville High School.
Sorry, could you turn the mic towards you? I couldn't hear you there. So you are?
Emma Dunn from Calderville High School.
Emma, thank you.
This is for the fourth opposition speaker, the final one. You said that poor people will always be poor, but then you went on to mention everyone is equal. Sure, if poor people are still poor, everyone's not equal. Like, you sort of contradicted yourself there. You said that poor people will always be poor, but everyone's equal. Surely poor and rich can't exist in a society where everyone is equal.
Thank you. Yes, at the front.
My name is Fraser MacDonald and I'm from Perth High School. I have a point of information for the fourth opposition speaker. You said in absolute terms that everyone is just like a clump of atoms stuck together. We don't mean anything. I don't understand how, just because it matters more to me that my life's going to last a bit longer than it matters to Sandy how long my life is going to last. I don't know how that affects whether or not we should prioritise economic equality. I don't see how this affects the bill at all, and I think it was just like a... It felt like you were filling some extra time. Yeah.
Thank you. You don't have to comment on what the speeches that were made. You can also make your own point for the minute. And it's unlikely I'm going to have time to come back to our debaters at the front. If I do, I'll give them the opportunity to pick up some of the points, but I may not be able to come back to them. So I'm going to go over to the young man at the back at the right-hand side. Yep, except the microphone behind you is on. Sorry, I'll come to you next.
Toby Appleyard, Clifton Hall. Toby Appleyard, Clifton Hall. Throughout the debate, the opposition generalised poor people. They said, we will help poor people. Poor people need our help. This will benefit poor people. But you never specified truly what you mean. Do you mean poor people that are employed? Do you mean poor people that are unemployed? Do you mean single mothers? Do you mean anyone who struggles in an ethnic minority? I think that the government really needs to think through its actions before they do anything, or before they even consider to do anything. I think the fact that you haven't even thoroughly recognised who this is actually going to apply to, it just proves that you're not thinking this through.
Thank you. Front here, please.
If you don't mind, I'll go for a hat-trick. So this is for finishing opposition.
Your name, please.
Sandy Malcolm from Perth High School. You talked about life being the best thing for people in your little speech about rainbows and flowers. And I thought, how can you talk about happy poor people in the current capitalist government where political parties such as the Tories, let's face it, prey upon the poor in a bid to keep the rich rich and the poor even poorer?
Thank you. To the left at the back, please.
Dominic Miller, Holy Cross High School. There was a really sort of, I think this was touched on briefly earlier, but there's this really sort of weird train of thought with the opposition, sort of the idea that we seem to be able to focus on is ourselves, that it doesn't matter what's happening with everyone else. It matters about we only really need to be concerned about what's happening with us. I feel that's really detached. I mean, we as a country, we're standing here with people who debate motions deciding what's the best for this country. If we follow the opposition's train of thought that every person should only should mainly focus only on themselves, and I'm not saying that we aren't the centre of our own universe, because I think every individual person does have the right to pursue and find happiness. But if this train of thought were the idea that we ourselves are more important than anything else, and that it doesn't matter what other people are going through, is quite disturbing in a way, because, like I said, we sort of have a responsibility, the people who debate here every day have a responsibility to sort of come up what's best for our country, and ultimately, shouldn't the best thing for our country be, should it not be the benefit of the nation as a whole, and surely that means individual people. And the point about the minimum wage, the fact that if we give a little bit to the minimum wage, that's somehow going to affect us. Everyone's going to be going in food banks. No, they're not, because food banks are a product of recession. Food banks are a result of people who, because there is a huge imbalance between the rich and the poor, people are forced to go into these food banks. They did not exist years ago when the recession wasn't around, but now it's around. Food banks are appearing everywhere, and it's because there is this mentality that we can only look after ourselves, and that ultimately the pursuit of profit over society as a whole, it's damaging. I should wrap up. Right, sorry. I think the basic point I'm trying to make is, we are more and more becoming the world. Everyone's becoming connected as a whole. And if we have this mentality where we can only think about ourselves, then how can we look after our own country? And therefore, if we can't look after our own country, how can we expect to come together as part of a world? And quickly, to finish off, to answer the question about where we're going to get all this money, I'll tell you, quoting Russell Howard without the swear word, stop targeting poor people and target companies like Amazon and Google by getting them to pay their fair share of their taxes.
Thank you. Ask everyone else to try and keep to a minute if possible. Right at the back, young woman. Yep. Yes.
Okay. I'm Jessica. I'm from St. Columbus. The problem highlighted by proposition in opening speeches seemed to be that we have this society that shuts out people who can't efficiently work, and from that you get like a cycle of poverty, you get inequality. And I don't see how that was ever addressed by the mechanism that they gave out. Like, giving a lump sum of money to a person just doesn't help you with these problems. It doesn't make you more employable. At the point, you don't get more employable skills, you don't get better qualifications, you don't get the kind of thing that makes you attractive to someone who's looking for someone to employ, and therefore you never get like an income of your own, you never get the kind of autonomy that side proposition want to give people. So at the very like best, it seems to be like a useless mechanism, and at the worst, it actually does a lot of damage to these people at the point of which the government loses actual money and also political capital to help them in other ways, such as improving education and actually addressing the root causes of poverty.
Thank you. To the right, please. Yep.
So no one's really... my name. Ewan Huey, Greif High School. So everyone kind of accepted that economic inequality is like a cost of prosperity. And I think that's really frustrating, because economic equality can be a cause of prosperity, because inequality is incredibly damaging to our economy. And you look at like the rest of Western Europe, they all have high-speed trains, because its benefit to the wider economy is greater than it could ever be to an individual shareholder. And therefore, if we like break down and actually distribute and divide wealth and power within our nation, then everyone actually has the power to pursue their own economic self-interest rather than a few people pursuing theirs at the cost of everyone else. It's not perfect, but that's what I suggest. Thank you.
Many thanks. And right at the back, please. Yep. Yes.
Oh, Jesus, that's loud. Okay, hi, I'm Freddie Gilmore from St. Columba's. And basically, what we got a lot of from Closing Proposition was this idea that, sort of in reply to what Opposition was saying about how we need to sort of help inequality, you know, multinationally between us and more, like, less developed countries, their answer to that was kind of, we don't have the money that we could put into helping to develop these countries due to the fact that we're bailing out large multinational companies. So my question for them, I have two questions. Firstly, under the motion, under the mechanism, essentially what you would be doing, as opposed to taking that money and then putting it into helping to develop developing countries, you would in fact just be taking it and redistributing it between citizens of the UK, so we don't think it actually helps developing countries. And secondly, we think that when you're not bailing out a country, we think that, a company, we think that company fails, and what happens is, firstly, you lose all the jobs that have been created in the UK, so we think that that's going to lead to, you know, high unemployment and high, you know, inequality due to the fact that people are out of jobs and they need welfare, but that's all being spent in, like, this lump sum. And secondly, we think that company isn't able to expand and able to actually invest in these developing countries and help the economies there and create jobs there. So, okay, bye.
Thank you very much. Okay, yourself, yep, you've had your hand up for some time, young man.
My name's Adam McElroy, I'm from St. Maurice's High School. I'd just like to make the point that economic equality is impossible as long as we have a monetary economic system. The monetary economic system survives through inequality, it thrives off of it. There is no value in money if you don't have scarcity and inequality. And therefore, you can't have an equal system if you've still got money. So my advice to us as young people would be to look at an alternative. It's our moral responsibility as young people of this country to try and build a better society for ourselves. And the best way to do that is through looking at alternatives to a monetary economy, one which will be fairer for everyone, not just the big companies and big businesses. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else wishing to participate? Yes, next to... Was it Adam? Sorry. Yeah. Next to Adam.
Luke McPhee. I'm also from St. Maurice's High School. Wait,
I didn't catch your name.
Luke McPhee.
Luke.
In regards to the proposition, if everyone is to have equality in terms of income, as they suggest, would this not perhaps be proposing a more communist approach, which has been renowned for being somewhat ineffective throughout history, risking our capitalist society, which we are able to benefit from our motivation and prosperity?
Thank you. Yeah, front here, please.
Fraser McDonald, Perth High School.
I'd like to propose a situation where our government has some money and they need to decide what to spend it on. Should they spread it out equally, to, like, should they give a little bit to everyone, or should they invest it in something like the NHS, where the NHS can focus it on people who really do need it at that time? I also feel that the word equality is a word which is badly used. Equality doesn't mean that everyone gets the same thing. It means that everyone gets what they need. Yeah.
Thank you. So you had a second bite there because I didn't see any other hands. Would anyone else like to make a contribution? Yes, young woman.
Emma Baxter, Clifton Hall School. I'd like to suggest to the opposition that equality and overall prosperity are not mutually exclusive, because as a nation, we are all more prosperous if everyone in our society is able to live with dignity. Thank you.
Thank you. Is that us? Usually you run out of time, not people. Yes, young man.
I think it's important in this debate to focus on what type of equality we want and what type of equality is the fairest for the many at the bottom of society and the most powerful and the most influential to help them. I think this debate focused on equality of outcome. And I mean, I completely agree with opposition that growth is a much more important than a much kind of lower economic standing for everyone. But the issue is about how this money is spent. And we need to make society a fairer place. And the only way we can do that is through real social mobility. We only achieve that through investing in education. And ultimately, that's why equality of opportunity is much more important than the equality of outcome that proposition bring to the table.
Sorry, I didn't get you.
Sorry, Rory Elric, Edinburgh University.
Thank you. And to my left.
Okay, so what I want to do is dispel the myth of the Scandinavian model that is something that comes up in debating and Scottish politics quite a lot. The reason the Scandinavian model works is that we have a good quality of life, not for economic reasons, but for social reasons. Women get a benefit because you provide free, like, paternity leave, so the husband can take time off work so the woman can get back to work, or you provide, like, free childcare. By giving a lump sum, that's not going to solve anything. And in fact, in most Scandinavian countries, you have an incredibly high cost of living. So, like, we see that when you're trying to have an economy that runs quite low in terms of surplus, then there's going to be a high cost of living. So this lump sum is not going to actually affect the poorest people in society more, because they're not going to be able to save this money, because they're going to have to spend it on literally living. What we need to do to bring a Scandinavian model to Britain is to have these social reforms rather than the economic reforms. So that's why I don't think we can get a Scandinavian model under the model given to us by side proposition.
And I didn't get your name?
Connachie, University of Dundee.
Many thanks. Okay, any final opportunities at the back, please?
Okay, Liam Foley from Clifton Hall. So, I feel that the opposition contradicted themselves with their last two speakers. So, Forethought brought the point that only your own life is important to you, that it doesn't matter if someone else gets, you know, £30,000 a year if you're getting, like, 25 or something, that's more than usual. But then at the same time, they brought the point about how if we didn't do this, we would be able to give foreign aid to other countries. Do you not feel that a country should deal with its own huge problems and inequality instead of you know, dealing with someone else's problems before that?
Thank you.
Thank you. Now, I'm back to speakers that I've already called, and I'm conscious I've done that once before. Yep, at the front here.
So my name is Carla McDougall. I'm from the University of St. Andrews, and I would just actually like to voice an agreement with the opening government case, which I feel like has been few and far between, and especially the mechanism of the living wage. Because I think it was a bit frustrating that the opening opposition team seemed to treat the living wage and the amounts of money that would be as something that was inconsequential. But I think actually in real terms what it amounts to is those that are coming from impoverished backgrounds, it allows parents in particular maybe to say, I'm not going to have to take that evening job that I'm doing part-time because now I no longer financially have to do so. What does that mean? Well, it means particularly if they have young children that they are able to invest that time now into preparing good meals for them, to be able to watch them more carefully, to be able to help them with their homework. People say that, oh, we want to necessarily just invest in education. We don't think the living wage helps with that. But actually, you can see that particularly among younger age groups, that academic performance is mostly tied to the support that children receive in the home, and it's not necessarily connected to what school they're going to or the help that teachers can receive. There's a certain role that parents play. They know their children best. They're able to be able to now put resources in to say, look, we think you're doing really well at this extracurricular program in school. We're going to now be able to give you the money that you need to be able to pursue that further. We think these are the ways over the long term that you're actually able to level the playing field, to be able to say, look, we're going to better the chances for these young people in the future to be able to compete with those that are coming from affluent backgrounds. We think universities in particular, which are now one of the greatest ways to be able to get into the job market, is to be able to say, look at these extracurricular activities that these children have been engaged with, or say, look at the, academic performance that they've been able to achieve despite the school that they're coming to, or despite the background that they're coming through. I think that people have belittled maybe the long-term impacts that you're actually getting out of the government case, and I would support the proposition.
Thank you very much. And so back to two speakers that we had before. I think it's Emma. You're better to lift it up, Emma. Thank you.
This is for the first proposition speaker. You mentioned, and I think it was like the first 10 seconds of your speech, that you wanted to give the same income to everyone. I think that's a very communist, ideal, that you want to give the same income to everyone. And like maybe you've like come across wrong, but so you do want to take the people that earn big amounts of money, do you want to take that off them and give everyone the same amount of money for the same job, whether or not one job may be harder than the other? Like, are you coming, I think it might have come across more communist than you wanted it to.
Thank you very much. And Ewan, was it?
Yeah. I just have a wee question for everyone who used the term growth in their speech. As far as I'm aware, growth was a word that was first used by Milton Friedman in the 1970s. It had never been mentioned before that. And as far as I can ascertain, it doesn't have a distinct purpose other than to be used as a propaganda tool. So if anyone could give me an answer to that, that'd be great.
And if there's no one else who wants to contribute, well, there's three more people who want to contribute now. So very quickly, shelf at the back and then down to the front.
Hi, this is mainly for opening opposition. They basically said that when you introduce things like a living wage, you know, a really high minimum wage, it sort of discourages companies from coming into the UK and like investing their businesses there and starting their businesses there. But do you not think that that same argument was used against actually introducing the minimum wage in the first place and companies weren't deterred, like nothing happened, and it was used against the introduction of the living wage earlier, like last year or something, and again, nothing has happened. Also, there are a lot of other things that, you know, encourage companies to come to the UK, like the fact that it's a highly lucrative market, like the fact that people are regaining their confidence in actually spending and putting money into the economy. So, yeah.
Thanks very much. So, two final speakers. You've spoken before, yes? Just remind. Yep, at the front. Right. Remind me of your name, sorry.
It's Sandy Malcolm from Perth High School. And I don't know if it's me, but I don't really feel like either side's really acknowledge that it's the plural of government in the motion. It's how this believes governments should prioritise. And I feel like both sides only really touched upon our British government, which is obviously a capitalist. And they need to really translate how this notion would be introduced in other countries that are more like communists, like China. And it's like, we should really be thinking about other countries as well as just Britain itself.
Many thanks. And yes, young woman.
The status quo that the opposition support, capitalist incentives, isn't working. Rising levels of inequality have continued, especially over the last 30 years of individualistic governments. Why does this change in the op models? Do you support this?
And could I have your name? All right,
sorry, Catherine Birch, Clifton Hall.
Okay. And finally, young man, you've spoken before. Remind me of your name.
Toby Appleyard, Clifton Hall. I mean, this point was made throughout the debate, but if you're supporting to put in this wage for all these, you know, poor people, I've already taken issue with the word poor, but would you not agree that this money could actually be better spent in helping our society? Surely things like our struggling NHS. People mention Scandinavia and their governments and what makes them so good. But what makes them so good is their health system and is their education systems. Surely we could be putting that money into this if you truly want to achieve what they've achieved.
Thank you. So I'm going to return to our teams at the front very briefly. If someone, given a lot of the comments were aimed at your own contributions, does anyone want to volunteer to make any final comment from the opposition? No, nope. Done enough. That's fine. Proposition. Yep.
We have been accused of communism various times. I would have had great fun defending communism outright. Can we do that next year?
Well, I don't think I'll be here because there's an election in May, so I very much doubt if I'll be the Deputy Presiding Officer. But whoever it is, I'm sure it'll be passed on to them that contribution has come from yourself. Yes, please, Luca.
I could answer some of the questions. I can't remember who it was, but someone said to me that would all that money go to international aid? It would also go to other things, like mentioned, you know, our NHS, our education system, our welfare system.
Look, if you turn away, we can't hear you. Sorry.
But democratically appropriated. Someone mentioned how companies would go bust and people would lose their jobs. Cooperatives do not require shareholders or a CEO as such. So they take the hit of a global reform if there were a global economic recession, if there were to be one, much better and bounce back from it much quicker. Someone mentioned communism. That's just not true. Free market capitalism is actually retained in a social democracy. It's just a more fair way of promoting everyone getting the same way to excel to their best ability and be successful in a free market economy, while not just keeping the elite. The Scandinavian model actually follows everything that has been suggested that we should do, and we've actually said that this is the model we would like to follow. And that's all I have to say on the questions.
Thank you very much. I'm going to do a quick comfort break while I'm waiting on the judges to give me the winners. And so I'm going to ask, if you need to go out of the chamber, could you see one of our assistants who can help you with that, and we'll just have a comfort break for 5 minutes or so. Thank you. So I'm sorry if I take a few minutes just to get this right. I don't want to make any mistakes. So feel free to talk amongst yourselves for a moment or two longer.
Right, so thank you all very much for your contributions. We've heard some strong views on the topics, very well argued, and the quality of the debate has been absolutely fantastic. I'm really impressed and I applaud everybody for your efforts. But it's now time to announce the winners of the 2015 St Andrew's Day Debating Championship Final. And when I call your name, I'd be very grateful if you could join me and Kezia Dugdale on the chamber floor here to receive your prize, and we'll also take a photograph before you move back to your seat. So first of all, can I ask Kezia to come forward, please? Thank you. So the first prize of the evening goes to the best contribution from the floor, and this was the one that I had the honour of choosing. It was really difficult. There was some excellent contributions from the floor, which of course the judges didn't hear, but you may be able to watch them later. But my prize for this is going to go to Adam McElroy from St Maurice's High. Adam. Second prize of the evening goes to the best pupil judge of the day, and that of course is Michael Creakin from Holy Cross High School. And the third prize in this category goes to the best school speaker of the day, and that is Hannah McLaughlin from St Columba School. So this is the bit that I better get right.
after a really well-fought final, the runner-up of the 2015 St Andrew's Day Debating Championship goes to Team Mar Edgar.
Jenny and Chris, very well done.
And the winner of the 2015 St Andrew's Day Debating Championship goes to Team Perth Porter, Luca and Elliot. Can I now invite Simon Christie on behalf of the English-speaking Union Scotland to say a few words, please, Simon.
Deputy Presiding Officer, members of the Scottish Parliament, ladies and gentlemen, it is my privilege to thank this, our quite wonderful Scottish Parliament, for allowing the St Andrew's Day debate to take place. And I'd particularly like to thank Anne Donald and Joanne Kendall of the Parliament's events team, and indeed Lynn Robertson and the team at Education Scotland for their incredible support of this event. I'd also like to thank the judges for the final, Alex Orr, Nick Bibby, Kezia Dugdale, and of course Michael Creehan. Many congratulations to you, Michael, in this very first prize for Best Pupil Judge of the Day. And indeed, all the students from the great universities across Scotland, not only for judging and speaking in the earlier rounds and who make such an invaluable contribution to the work of ESU Scotland, not just at this event, but across all our schools' competitions. Thank you all very, very much indeed. The astute amongst you will have recognised that I've missed Alex Don out from the judging panel for the final. Many of you in the student debating community will know Alex as a very formidable debater indeed. However, I would like to thank him for his very hard work in his role as Speech and Debates Officer for ESU Scotland in making this day possible. Ladies and gentlemen, I would also like to thank the school champions. Who are they? Well, they are your wonderful teachers, your debating coaches, who in addition to their responsibilities to fulfil the national curriculum, find the time to help you discover the essential life skills which can be gained from debating and public speaking. They help you to increase your ability to articulate your point of view. They train you to analyse important topics that affect not just our society but the wider world. They train you to listen and hopefully to understand. We hope that you have enjoyed today, and when you return to your schools, you will wish to either start or continue to gain the benefits of debating. For if you do, then we believe that you have very, very bright futures ahead of you indeed. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you.
And those of you who've been at this debate before when I've been chairing it, you notice that I usually manage to make one small mistake, but this evening I've made a big mistake. Can I ask Kezia to come back out and join me, please? Because I've missed out a prize winner. And so, can I announce the best prize, the prize for the best university speaker of the day, and that's Chris Edgar from the University of Glasgow. Chris.
best to last, maybe, as they say. Can I now invite all of the winners and the judges to join me on the chamber floor for a group photograph? And just before you do that, can I say thank you to everybody for your efforts. I'm going to wish you all a safe journey back home, and please listen to the instructions from the events assistant as you leave the chamber. Congratulations to everybody, and thank you all for attending. Thank you and good night.